Would you like to see the difference between a competent cloud architect in an interview versus a highly certified cloud architect in an interview? If so, this video is for you. Hi, my name is Michael Gibbs, and I'm the founder and CEO of GoCloud Careers, an organization that's truly dedicated towards building the most high-performance cloud computing careers. Personally, I've been working in technology now for over 25 years, and I've been helping others get their first tech job or get promoted in tech for more than 2 decades. And I want to help every one of you get cloud hired and cloud promoted. In today's video, we're going to do the cloud architect interview or the solution architect interview. And I want to make it clear to you, what is a winning interview versus someone that says, I'm certified, and actually is not competent, because I want you all getting hired. So in this interview, we're going to have Alonzo Coleman from my team. He's going to be the hiring manager, and he's going to interview 2 versions of me. In version 1, I am going to be 10x AWS certified, and I'm going to answer the questions like I typically get on an interview when I deal with someone with a lot of certifications. And mind you, I've interviewed thousands upon thousands of people in the last 20-some years. Now, by comparison, next, you're going to have a real cloud architect that's competent that will get hired on the interview, demonstrate how it should be done. And I feel it's important for you to understand the difference between cloud certified versus cloud hireable, and also how to maximize the solution architect interview, the cloud architect interview. So here we go. We're going to have an interview with Alonzo and I.
Hello, how are you? Thank you so much for coming and interviewing for this opportunity. We are so excited to have you. And we'd just like to give offer a series of questions during this process. So first, tell me about yourself.
Alonzo, thank you so much for your time to meet with you. I'm so grateful for your time. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. I am 10X certified. I have gotten every certification from AWS Advanced Security, AWS Advanced Networking. I know Linux. I know Python. I know Terraform. And I've got every certification. I even did the Alexa to show you can know that I know all about cloud computing.
Hello, thank you so much for coming in and interviewing with us today. We'd like to know more about you, so could you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Absolutely, Alonzo. And first, thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to meet with you. A little bit about me. I am a cloud architect with a big background in solving customer problems through technology. Most of that technology is cloud solution, but I've been solving customer problems for a long period of time. With cloud technology, network technology, people, process, redesign, literally speaking, anything that it takes to truly improve my customers' business performance. I've got a big background in leading large teams of cloud engineers that do proof of concepts and deployments. And I've got a big background in designing, presenting, and selling, the things that most cloud architects do. But in addition to cloud architecture, I've got a background in teaching other cloud architects, mentoring other technology professionals as well.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Actually, we have a series of questions. We have a particular scenario that we'd like you to address. And if you could, we would love to hear what your solutions are for this particular problem. Now, we have a financial application that uses IP multicast. The application comes into the New York campus and the branch offices connects to the cloud for cloud-based applications and network transit to the main office. And how we can make this work, how would this happen or how would this occur as a solution across the AWS cloud?
Well, see, in my AWS Advanced Networking course, then they said when you want to use the network for transit, what you use is transit gateway. So it's got to be the transit gateway that's going to solve your problem here.
Now, we're going to have a potential, like a scenario that we'd like you to address and provide solutions for.
Of course.
So it goes a little bit like this. We have a financial application that uses IP multicast. The application comes in from our New York campus. The branch offices connect to the cloud for cloud-based applications and network transit to the main office. How would we make this work across the AWS cloud?
Of course, Alonzo. So you said you've got a campus, which is where your financial feeds come in, cloud, which is providing transit, and your remote access. Are your remote access people connected via VPNs, for example?
Yes, they are, as a matter of fact.
Okay, so I'm assuming all the transport is working already. Everything is there.
It is.
Okay, so assuming everything is in place, what we have to do is as follows. See, most clouds, AWS, Azure, Google, they don't allow IP multicast. but we still need to get that IP multicast to the destination for the financial application. So what we can do is at the source in your main data center in New York, we can set up a GRE tunnel, and we can create a different GRE tunnel to every different remote location. And we can run PIM across that GRE tunnel and then IGMP where the users are at, and we can create our IP multicast across the cloud throughout the environment. Your customers will do quite well.
Wow, thank you so much. That's a great answer. How would you secure your mission critical web app for an organization that has extreme security needs?
Absolutely. Good news. I took the AWS Advanced Security. We are going to use WAF. We're going to use Shield. We're going to use NACL. And we're even going to use a security group. And we can add some AWS MACI. And we got rock solid security, just like they taught me in the AWS Advanced Security.
So I have a couple of other answers, questions, if you'd like to participate.
Of course. I'd love to.
Wonderful. How would you secure your mission critical web app for an organization that has extreme security requirements?
Great question, Alonzo. And here we've got to get out of the cloud native security and we need something robust.
Okay.
So the first thing we want to do is set up our demilitarized zone. And what we're going to do is we're going to be using outside of that demilitarized zone, we'll use a content delivery network because they have the ability to stop a DDoS attack. And right behind that, we will put a next, what we're going to use is a network load balancer to front end two next generation firewalls. We want to use the network load balancer because we want to eliminate any single points of failure, and we want to get good performance. And these are going to be next generation firewalls from something like Cisco or Palo Alto or Fortinet or Checkpoint. The reason we're using a next generation firewall over something like WAF is as follows. Not only are they stateful firewalls that will block the attack, but if anything occurs, these firewalls have an integrated intrusion detection, intrusion prevention capability. So not only can they see the attack, they will stop it. But since you said it's mission critical, I'd probably use another set of network load balancers for a different set of next generation firewalls. Say the first two are Palo Alto, then maybe these two are Checkpoint. In case something bypasses our first firewall, we're gonna have a second set of firewalls. Now, once we pass those firewalls, we could use another set of intrusion detection, intrusion prevention systems, but it's probably not necessary because the two next generation firewalls that we've used in a stack. So what I'd go next is I would add an access control list. If we're on AWS, it's going to be a network access control list, and that's really going to protect the subnet from traffic. In case anything breached our firewalls, we still want some additional protections.
Wow.
Now, the next thing that I would do is I would add a security group, Alonzo. And that basically is like a firewall into the web servers themselves because we want layers like an onion, but it's still not enough, Alonzo. So after we do that, we're going to take our web servers, which ideally are Linux because they're typically more secure. And I want to do the following. We want to lock it down by disabling all unnecessary services. The next thing we want to do is put some host-based anti-malware and an additional host-based firewall on the system. We want to make sure these servers are patched. Now, that's the basis of the majority of what we need to do. Obviously, we've got a lot of logs that are coming out of something like this. So because we have all these logs from all our devices, we can create some event-driven security policies should we need to. We can additionally take those logs and put it into a visualization engine like Tabula to see what's going on in real time. But realistically speaking, it's about setting up the correct demilitarized zone, which is really about your firewalls, your next-generation firewalls, at least two of them, followed by your access control list, your security groups, and then what you do to the host.
Wow, that is awesome, Michael. Thank you so very much for that. Could you share a compare and contrast of types of storage on AWS?
Of course, I'm even storage certified. Do you know we've got elastic block storage, and that's the stuff you stick on your virtual machine? It's fast, fast, fast. And we also have this great stuff called Amazon Simple Storage Solution. And what we do is we create a bucket, and we put our stuff in there. We also have something called Elastic File System, which we can use as sharing stuff between our Linux systems.
We also would like to know what your solution would be or definition of, could you compare and contrast types of storage on AWS for us?
Absolutely. So AWS, just like any data center, has your three primary forms of storage. We have our block storage, our object storage, and our file storage. I'll begin with object storage. And object storage and block storage are both storage area networks, which means they're basically systems that are filled with hard drives or RAID arrays. Now, object storage is a little bit different. See, the data comes in and it gets broken down to an object. Now, this is really interesting because when the data is broken down into an object, there's an addition of something called metadata, which is actually data about the data. That metadata makes object storage very special. And I'll explain to you why. But before we do, let's talk about object storage. It's write once, read many times, because as soon as we put something in object storage, As soon as we touch the file, modify the file even one bit, it creates a new version. So object storage cannot be mounted by computers, which would have things that change constantly like a swap file or would fill up our RAID arrays immediately. Object storage is great for backup on iCarvo purposes, software distribution, for example, and big data. Now, previously I mentioned that object storage has metadata, which is data about the data. That data enables us to run SQL queries on our data, integrate it into a data lake. So that's what we typically use object storage for. Now let's talk about block storage. Block storage is another type of storage area network where your data is broken down into blocks. Now, because the data is broken down into blocks, it looks and feels very similar to the way a traditional hard drive breaks data down into blocks, even though it's not a traditional hard drive. So what happens is we typically use block storage in the cloud the same way we use it in the data center as pseudo virtual storage that our servers connect to. And by doing so, we can decouple our compute and our storage environment. So anywhere in our data center or even on our IP network, we can actually have these block storage RAID arrays and we can connect to them by our service and it makes it feel local. So because of the decoupling of the storage and the hardware, it scales incredibly well. And that's your primary storage used by your servers, your virtual machines in the cloud. Now, lastly, you mentioned file storage. Now, of course, we've got Windows file storage, which uses the server message block protocol. And we have Unix Linux storage, which uses something called NFS, or the network file system, invented by Sun Microsystems decades ago. But in AWS, they add the term elastic to it, like they add to everything else. And they have something called elastic file storage, which is basically NFS with an AWS branding. Why do we use network file storage? If we've got one server that needs to share data with, say, 50 servers at the same time, that's why we're using file storage.
Outstanding, Mike. You really, really drilled down to that definition, and we really appreciate your response for that. Okay, next question. How would you load share across direct connections without getting out-of-order packets?
Oh, I use an elastic load balancer. It's the right way to do it. And there's lots of training on the elastic load balancer in the AWS Advanced Networking and that AWS Certified Solution Architect Professional.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Next question. It would be, how would you load share across direct connections without getting out of order packets?
Oh, Alonzo, what a great question. And see, here's the thing. Whenever we're using a direct connection to the cloud, if they'd be on the same service provider, we wouldn't have this problem because they'd go out one link, they'd be coming back the other, but the latency would be the same. But we're never going to build a high availability network with a single service provider. So let's say we've got one direct connection off of AWS and another direct connection on Azure, AT&T and Verizon. We don't want our packets to go out the AT&T link and come back on the Verizon link. We get out of order packets. So we have a few options. To load share, what we'd have to do is, for example, we could leak a more specific subnet on one link and a more specific subnet on another link, and then we can control which traffic would go where. Now, we could do that just by basically putting advertising one subnet on one link and another on another, or We could prepend a subnet on one link and make it look less appreciative and prepend a different subnet on another link. And that way we could load share. We could change the local preference of certain routes and load share that way. We could change the weights on certain routes. We could even match a community and set up a routing policy, but it's all based in BGP and it's all determining your traffic engineering. I could work through any situation if you give me specifics.
Outstanding, Mike. You have really, really answered our questions more than we even expected, and we really appreciate your time. Last question, why should we hire you?
You should hire me because I have lots of energy, so much so that I did all 10x AWS certifications, so you can see how competent I am. I learned Python, I learned coding, I learned development, I learned all the sysops, I learned Terraform, I'm your person, I can code and configure anything you need.
Now we have one more question for you, and sure. We need to know, why should we hire you?
Alonzo, you should hire me for the following reasons. I am someone that will work hard to solve your customers' problems and make your customers successful. I'm a great team player. I've got a lot of experience bringing out the best in others, and I won't quit until the job is done. With you have me on your team, you can feel safe and secure that you know your customers will be well served. The people on your team, I'll be bringing out the best in others. And I'm always going to look after your best interests.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. We're really excited with your answers to our questions. You have fulfilled all the requirements and checked all the boxes on those questions. So thank you so much. Okay. Well, thank you so much for answering our questions. Do you have any questions for me?
Yes. What's the work-life balance like in your company?
Ah, I see. Well, we can definitely answer these questions at a later date. But I thank you so much for your time. We thank you so much for taking the time to apply with us, and we will respond with you very shortly.
Thank you so much. I look forward to hearing back from you, Alonzo.
Do you have any questions for us?
Alonzo, I have one question for you. Could you tell me your goals so that if I know if I was on your team, I could make you successful? Because it's truly important that whatever team I'm on, I make the manager, the team, and the company successful.
Thank you so much. We really appreciate that thoughtfulness. One of the things that we're really focused on is driving sales and creating a very inclusive team that is really focused on getting the job done, meeting requirements of clients, maintaining client relations, and being able to be innovative in that approach. And we'd like to have someone like you to fill that spot for our organization.
Alonzo, thank you for letting me know that information. I am confident I can help you with all those things.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Mike. We really look forward to getting some responses to you very soon.
Thank you so much. I hope you've enjoyed this video on cloud architect interviews. I hope it was enlightening to see what we see as hiring managers when someone comes in with a million and one certifications and wants to tell us about the certifications versus when a competent cloud architect comes in and proves to us that they're completely competent. I also hope you learned how to master the cloud architect interview, or at least get some insight into the cloud architect interview. I'd like to tell you about some things that we have to help build your technology career. If you're looking to get your first cloud architect job, we have a completely free How to Get Your First Cloud Architect Job webinar every Thursday. And on this webinar, we'll tell you everything you need to know to build your best cloud computing careers. And I come online completely free on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays to answer any kind of cloud computing questions you have to help you build the best cloud computing career. And if you're looking to win the interview on your next cloud architect interview, solution architect interview, or cloud engineer interview, we have a tech interview mastery program that will teach you how to master the interview and dazzle the hiring manager with how great you are so you get cloud hired. I look forward to seeing you in another video very soon.